Well, good morning, everybody. Thank you for joining me this morning. I really appreciate that. I know your time is valuable, and so we really appreciate you joining us here today for our little update. I'm Jeff Ray, the CEO here at the Chamber. Throughout the pandemic, we've been trying to give you periodic updates on just kind of things that the Chamber's involved in that are happening. We want to make sure you stay connected. And so that's the purpose today. So I want to just say thank you for joining us. And we intend this to be interactive. So as the discussion goes today, if you have questions or we'll have some time at the end too, feel free to ask those questions. We couldn't do the things we do at the Chamber without great partnerships. And one of our great partners is the Center for Hospice. They have been our member briefing sponsor throughout this year. Sarah Young's from Hospice is with us. I'm going to just turn over to Sarah real quick for a quick hello before we get into our update. Sarah?
Sure. Thanks, Jeff, for having me. I'm Sarah Youngs with Center for Hospice Care. We are a community-based, not-for-profit organization. We provide hospice services, palliative care, grief counseling, and community education. Our grief counseling is free to our community, and we're always looking for ways to help and educate. We service 9 counties in northern Indiana, and our mission is to improve the quality of living for everyone on our services, and really just to create meaningful relationships and experiences for both patients and the community. And we have a lot of educational opportunities for area businesses. So if you'd like more information about us or what we do, you know, please reach out, and always glad to be here. Thanks, Jeff.
Great. Thanks, Sarah. And thanks for the great partnership. Really appreciate that. And thanks to so many of you, a lot of great partners on the phone with us today or on the call. So really appreciate that. I want to get into just providing you just a couple quick updates. Some of this you're going to know and some you won't and such. So I just want to give you our perspective on a few things that are happening here in our area. During this global pandemic time, it's hard to do any of these updates without talking briefly about the coronavirus and COVID and how it's impacting our community. And so I'm going to spend just a couple of minutes with kind of a highlight of a couple of things that are going on there. Obviously, you've seen the news that our cases continue to spike. Indiana is one of the faster growing states. I think I saw today we're in the top 15 in terms of the fastest growing states. That's a list that we don't want to be on. We'd like to be on the other end of that. Counties across Indiana are growing. Our county and the counties that surround us have had growing numbers as well. And you've seen, I'm guessing, that the continued reports on the news about taxing hospitals and the capacity there and the staffing challenges created by the number of people that are needing to be hospitalized by the virus. So it's still very real, and we still are encouraging folks to be diligent in their gathering and such, and try to do everything they can to limit the spread. You know, from the business community standpoint, we very much want the economy to be open. We know many of you had challenging times surviving the first go around here, and our hope is that we don't have a second showdown or shutdown, and so we continue to encourage folks to social distance, to wash their hands, to use hand sanitizer, to wear masks, all the things they can do to keep the economy open. And I've been overwhelmed by our business community and the response they've been given. I've rarely been to a spot in town where they weren't requiring masks and that kind of stuff. And so I do think that the business community has responded in that interest of trying to stay open. But we're sensitive to the plight of the hospitals and what's going on there. There have been great rumors that this week we might roll back some of our reopening plans. The governor was very clear on that yesterday, that there's no immediate plan to do that, but they'll continue to monitor those numbers. On our radar here in St. Joe County, on Tuesday night next week, the county council will consider a fine mechanism that goes along with masks. This has been debated over the last couple months and will be considered again on Tuesday night. There's, as you can guess, with all things coronavirus, there's some very polarized thoughts on this, some extremes on both ends of this. Our work with the health department has really been in I would say kind of a proactive approach to all of these. I don't think the health department's looking to go out and make a bunch of money by finding a bunch of businesses for not wearing masks. And in fact, I've been with them almost every day on a call to talk about, you know, kind of what's happening here locally with the coronavirus, and been with them in a number of businesses as well, talking about the proactive steps the businesses take. And I just want to remind you, there's a couple of those that will keep you out of trouble no matter what, you know, should any additional requirements come. And the health department has a small checklist. I'm going to go over a couple of them real quick. Make sure you have proper signage at your entrance. I think most of you have done that. Make sure your employees are wearing masks, especially if you're in a situation where you have customers coming and going. Make sure there's hand sanitizer at the entrance. Make sure physical distance is being practicing. If you're a restaurant, patrons need to be seated while they're consuming food or drink, and seating needs to be about 6 feet apart. And as part of the state requirement, you had to have a COVID response plan too, and hopefully you've all done those things already. So I'm not sure if I was to predict, I would predict that the county council, I think, will pass that ordinance on Tuesday evening. And I think there are a few businesses out there that aren't doing some of the right things. And I think those will be early targets. And again, I think if you're following some of those basic requirements there, you're not going to have any new trouble there. The other thing I would mention is just that most recently on the coronavirus is related to return to work, because there are a number of businesses out there that want a negative test prior to somebody coming back. And folks, as soon as they get that negative test, are pretty sure that they should be able to come back to work. And I sort of get that. Workers, you know, want to get paid, and businesses need workers. But there's a lot of guidance out there on that return to work. And I think the quarantine thing is the one I would continue to remind folks of, is that's the really important thing, is that you quarantine for that 10 to 14 day period after symptoms go away, and that the negative test, I think, doesn't necessarily mean that your symptoms are all gone. So I'm not a medical expert. I couldn't speak to some of that, but I just encourage you to follow, you know, some of what you're seeing out there. Obviously, I'm sure some of you have experienced this now in your businesses. And if you haven't, feel free to call us. We're happy to walk you through or connect you with others that have had the, you know, challenges you know, related to that. Before I move on, any questions related to COVID, our response, the stuff that we're, you know, doing daily with the health department or others, or any reaction even to the mask ordinance or comments that we should take in mind prior to Tuesday's hearing? Well, feel free to email me those at any time. I'll put my email address in the chat, or call me at 400-4000 is the easiest way to get a hold of me if you have comments and want to consider some other things as we go forward. But we'll continue to stay up to date. You know, we don't think this is going away anytime soon, and we're working closely with our healthcare providers and the health department. I will tell you that having talked to many officials across the state, we have one of the better response efforts in our county of any, I think, in the state, and that gives me some comfort. And I've been in on calls, like I said, almost daily with our local professionals, both at the systems and at the health department. And I think there's some really good people in there. And I'll use bars as an example. Bars have been a little bit of a target because a lot of people gather there. We've had some really productive discussion with bars in terms of trying to find what that common ground looks like. The bar owners obviously haven't had much business and want to stay open. At the same time, the health department has a desire to make sure people stay safe. And so they've, I think, found some good common ground there, and we've had some good success so far. So we'll continue to work on that. And like I said, we're in this discussion really every day. So if you have comments, questions, or concerns, you know, feel free to share those with us. I'm going to shift gears away from COVID and spend the bulk of our time today talking about other things that we're doing related to economic recovery and other things that traditionally your chamber functions. And I want to go first to elections because chamber's traditionally been very involved in elections and again this year, a lot of really key races. You know, our focus sometimes has been on those races that don't get as much attention on television or in the news as others, but stand, you know, really critical for us. And hopefully you had a chance before the election to see our candidate conversations. I sat down with quite a few candidates, county commissioners, our candidates, board candidates, just in an effort to help you get to know them a little bit better. We were overwhelmed by how many people took advantage of watching those videos, and we'll work to continue to improve that process here over the next couple of years and such. But I'm really pleased that folks said they just felt like they got to know this candidate a lot better, and we're glad that we did that. We also participated in a program called One More Voice, and we were hoping to get more people registered to vote. And I think that the end result is we had some of the best participation that we've had in quite some time. And although I was surprised to see that it mirrored 2008 participation, I thought we blew away every single record. But anyway, people in St. Joe County came out to vote, people around Indiana, around the country did. And our hope was that folks, we were agnostic to, what the political party was. We wanted to get them out to vote and let the candidates make their case for why they should be the one selected. And so there's obviously at the national level, still some things to sort out. At the state level, the governor race, Governor Holcomb garnered the most votes ever by a governor candidate. And obviously we had the governor up just a couple weeks ago, and so really pleased to have him with us. The governor was has been very generous with his time with us. We have a great pipeline to him. He's got Northern Indiana on his radar, and we look forward to working with him as the new year begins. Locally, though, still a lot of things unsettled. If you saw news last night about 14,000 new absentee ballots got counted yesterday. There's about 15,000 left, I think, is what I saw from the news account. So the counters are back diligently sorting through those today. And we think we should see final numbers either late today or tomorrow at the very latest and such. And this is a diligent process to make sure all those mail-in ones now get counted. And so I want to mention just a couple of races there. I want to start with school board, South Bend School Board, for example. And those are all really, too close to call, and they could change significantly with more votes in. You know, currently, if it was to end the way it ends today, we'd be looking at three new South Bend School Board candidates, which I'll be honest, was a little surprising to us, given the spring 60-40 passing of the referendum. We felt like that the community had a lot of confidence in the current direction and the current leadership there. But if it ends the way it looks now, three incumbents could potentially lose there. And so we're watching that race pretty closely, because what happens in the schools is really important to our work. Here, the schools build the pipeline to the workforce, and we've been working really close with South Bend Schools on a lot of issues. We're excited about the work they're doing with their strategic plan, with their efficiency study that they're doing. We're encouraged by the extension of the superintendent contract, and happy that he will be here to provide some leadership. And so all things, have been going in the right direction. That's not to say they wouldn't if things change, but we're keeping a close eye on that, and I think we all would agree there's improvements that need to happen there, and we felt like they were headed in that direction. So we'll be watching those closely. In Mishawaka, we're thinking potentially two new ones if it was to end as it is today. One elected not to run, another one may have been defeated in the election should it end up that way. So again, Mishawaka is very similar, with a lot of confidence in what's happening over the last couple of years, but some good candidates too. And I think that's the hard thing on both sides, in South Bend and Mishawaka, great candidates and such, but just some uncertainty there. And so we watch on what happens on the Mishawaka school board race. There's two outstanding county commissioner races, some great candidates on both of those races, Deb Fleming, Haj Patel in that district, Oliver Davis, Derek Dieter, and the others. And those two currently lean Fleming and Dieter in terms of where the vote counts are. But again, still 15,000 votes to be counted today. And so we'll know for sure how that goes. And those of you who aren't familiar, the commissioner is really kind of like the mayor of the county, if you will, oversees the executive branch, the day-to-day operations of county. So those are really critical races as well. So we're watching those very closely as well. And then we're also watching what happens in the General Assembly. And It looks like at least one may have flipped in St. Joseph County, potentially another that's close. Jake Teschka, Ross Deal. Teschka has a slight edge in that race right now. Dale Devon, Don Westerhausen, Dale Devon with a slight edge in that one right now. And then Ryan Dvorak and Tim J. Cox, I think is the name. That one's also really close. And so all three of those, I think everybody be watching as those final votes come in. I think one of the, you know, in the old days, you could predict some of this a little bit better because you knew which votes were outstanding. And right now it's a little harder because of vote centers and all that to know where those 15,000 votes come from. And so we'll have a process today where they finalize the counts on those, and things may look a lot different. And, you know, one thing, you know, that many of you join the chamber or support us, you know, for our advocacy efforts. And we work really hard to develop relationships with those elected officials on both sides of the aisle. And we've had really great relationships with so many of those incumbents that are there and with many of those challengers who have thrown their name in the hat and potentially are winners in this coming election. But we know that a good business climate is really critical to your success, and common sense leaders at all levels of government are really important. And so we're working and pledged to work with in any of those on both sides of the aisle. And you know, I am often encouraged that people talk about Republican and Democrat during an election, but once the election's over, people don't spend a lot of time talking about that. And it's really about good governing, and we'll continue to emphasize that and follow those closely. And so you'll see us typically active in Washington, D.C., in Indianapolis, here at the County City Building or City Hall in Mishawaka, because we're here to represent your interest. And we have about the business interest of about 1,300 businesses here in our region. And so we'll continue to work, you know, toward a lot of those and know that we've got to have good people to do that. Got to be an excruciating for candidates. I'm a former elected official, and I used to have to wait almost an hour, hour and a half, sometimes 2 hours to get, you know, the results in my race, and have to spend a couple days is just excruciating. And those candidates have put their own lives on hold a little bit to run for office, and their family and them have made amazing sacrifices to run. I'm really grateful to all of them who have thrown their hat in the ring and ran for office, because as you all see, it can be ugly this day and age. You know, good people with good hearts, you know, trying to make a difference here in our community. And so we'll be watching that closely, and we'll give you final updates in future written publications as those final results come in. I want to just touch on a couple other advocacy efforts too, because even though the coronavirus is happening, our advocacy efforts have not. Talking about at the national level, our chamber, as well as our colleagues from around the country, are hoping that even a lame duck session of Congress will lead to some action. So there are three things that we're very heavily involved in the conversation with. One is really that next COVID relief package. There was a lot of talk about that happening before the election. It never did. We're going to continue to encourage that package to move forward, and hoping that Congress takes some action before the end of the year. Maybe for about the last 4 years in Congress, they've been talking about doing something with infrastructure, and we think the lame duck session might be a good chance to advance things on the infrastructure side. Obviously, things like South Shore and some of those are really critical that rely very heavily on the federal government helping, and so we'd love to see an infrastructure package go forward. And then we've been involved in a lot of discussion about immigration reform as well too, and so that again, that's on the list of my colleagues from around the country as things that we want to continue to push on the national level. On the state level, the General Assembly will begin thinking about meeting here pretty quickly, and before the end of November with their organization day, and then back in session just after January. We've been proactively meeting with some of our legislators and contemplating, you know, what are the issues that are going to affect us, you know, next year that we need to be thinking about. We've been big advocates for regional models for funding, similar to like what happened with regional cities and such. I don't know. It may be too early to know yet what might survive the budget session next time, but our colleagues and us are kind of meeting diligently to sort of talk about what an agenda might look like and what key issues need to be addressed. It is a budget year, and so a pretty robust session. You know, we're going to plan, and maybe because of technology, it might be easier. I don't know. But one of the more popular things that we've done is been our third house sessions, and so likely we may not be able to do those in person, and so we'll work to bring legislators in to give you updates from the state house. Our members have found that valuable in terms of the weekly update of what's going on from the state house directly and hear firsthand from our legislators. And we'll continue to do programs like that into the next year as the legislative session starts to ramp up. And then locally, you know, obviously we play a big role in kind of following the things that are going locally. You know, I want to mention one thing that I want to mention tax abatement in the county, because there have been two editorials. There's one in today's South Bend Tribune from Joe Cannarecki from the county council, and there was one last week from Marty Wolfson, Mike Kruk, and Daryl Heller about the county's decisions on tax abatement. And I also wrote a response piece to that. I thought the county council did a nice job of trying to decide some very difficult projects. And one was a project where an owner had was going to double the size of his business. He'd been here in our county for quite some time. Employment increase. He asked for a tax phase in, and a few folks disagreed with it. The county council ultimately thought it was a good decision and moved forward. And then one related to a housing development out on the northwest side of the county. And I would just say on that one, it's a different approach than I think I've ever seen done on residential subdivisions in the county. And I applaud the county for being, you know, forward thinking and trying to think about how to do this on the front end rather than the back end. And I think we all know that someday somebody's going to have to make some big decisions about water and sewer up on the northwest side of the county. And this was kind of a proactive step on the front end, where I think it cost the county a lot less on the front end than it would cost them, you know, to come in on the back end and solve a potential problem later on and such. So anyway, things like that are hard. I would say on tax abatement, elected officials wish they didn't have to do any. But unfortunately, there are other cities that do. Sometimes we're competing against other communities. Sometimes it's just what a business needs to make a project move from concept to reality. And the county's really worked hard to be more business friendly. And I saw this as a really productive step to help the businesses that needed to grow and such. Anyway, so I encourage you to read those, and we'll have some additional correspondence about it, just kind of talking about our position related to those as well. Too. I wanted to highlight one other thing that we're working on, our manufacturing days. And over the last, 5 or 6 years, we've had a chance to introduce about 4,000 high school students from two states and about 9 different high schools and to about 70 different business partners across our region. And this year, we obviously had to pivot because of COVID-19, and we came up with what I think is a terrific platform to introduce future job and career opportunities to young people in our area. I would encourage you to visit our website and check out the Manufacturing Days portion of it, where we have really a whole catalog of things, you know, for you to see, whether it's our career expectation pathways or the PowerPoint presentations we've developed for teachers to use in the classrooms, or videos from real people in those companies that are telling you why they'd want to, you know, why you'd want to consider a career there. I'm really encouraged by what's happening. Model here that could be replicated in some other spots and stuff. So, you know, I think our healthcare industry is going through the same thing, right? Where we're finding workers can be a challenge, and we need to make sure that folks know about those opportunities. Or construction trades, we tested this with construction trades last year and would like to do more on that as we, and so all of this really aimed at trying to get the next generation of worker on path to future job opportunities and stuff. So I just encourage you to spend a few time or a few minutes like looking at that. And if you're in one of those industries where you think, boy, the chamber could help, and if we could pull some key partners together and do something similar, feel free to reach out, because we really see a big piece of our role these days is helping you, especially on the workforce side of things. It's the number one thing that our folks identify as their big challenge, even in the midst of a pandemic where unemployment's a little higher than it was back in January. It's still a challenge to find those quality people. And so we're spending a lot of time in this space, and we're working to help you on that kind of stuff. I want to shift and just talk for a quick second about, some upcoming things on our calendar. Obviously, the ability to gather is challenged because of our interest in keeping everybody safe. We are doing a few things that we saw quite a few of you at Bar Louie, and a great chance to introduce you to the space and a great new project up on Mishawaka's north side. And we've got a couple coming up that I want to make sure that you know of. One of the most proud parts of our brand is our YPN program. And so we have a YPN event at lunchtime on Tuesday next week, our cause and effect event. And I would encourage you to visit our website and find out more about that. And if you're young professionals or struggling with connecting with other people or new to the area, I really encourage you to plug them into YPN and what's going on. It's over the lunch hour on Tuesday. They're gonna have lunch anyway and stuff. So, but we're gonna bring it straight to them because they can do it virtually and such. So I encourage your YPs to sign up for that. We're working to continue to develop quality young professional programming so that that our young people see value in that and stay connected. On Monday, November 16th, we're doing our next networking at lunch. I've got Larry Tracy. Larry's the CEO or the president of Memorial Hospital and part of Beacon Health System over there. So Larry's and his team obviously are on the front lines of what's going on, especially with COVID and much like, St. Joe and Beacon and Memorial and Goshen, all the hospitals are, kind of tackling this. We've got Larry joining us for a conversation and kind of some updates and such. If you don't know, Larry's a good chance to hear from him, but also just hear just more directly what's going on the health system side of things. And you've heard, like I say, you've seen a little bit of the news on that, but here's firsthand, you'll hear from Larry. That's on Monday, November 16th at noon. So I would encourage you to join us for that. And then on also that same week, Thursday the 19th at 7:30 in the morning, we're doing our coffee and conversations over at Cultivate. And so Cultivate, some of you have seen their story, just a phenomenal food, I'm not going to describe it well, food rescue, food recovery. They're taking food and repackaging it and helping feed, hungry people all over our area. It's a tremendous story. If you haven't seen them, they are over on Sample Street, I believe. The name is just off Sample. It's I don't know. The name's escaping me right now, but on our website, you'll see that and you can go visit and sort of see what they're doing and hear more about their story. There's a phenomenal new, not new anymore, but new organizations doing some great things here in our community. And so Stan's Food, a longtime member here, a longtime part of our community, and Cultivator teaming up, bring you that on November 19th. So, we've been really inspired by your stories of perseverance, and we applaud you for continuing to innovate. We know this year has been like no other, and we're grateful for your perseverance and the things you're doing to really help navigate these difficult times and the lessons that you're providing for other businesses and such. So, at the same time, we're grateful for your continued support of our organization. We think that even in the middle of challenging times, the need for the services that we deliver is critical. And we're out, my team and I are out every day, kind of trying to speak on your behalf, to find resources on your behalf, or connect you to other potential partners and such. So please, at no time hesitate reaching out to us. We're here work on your behalf and hoping that this becomes a little blip on the radar, and that into 2021 that we put a lot of this behind us and that we have some progress, if you will, and get this behind us and stuff. So, I talked for a long time, and I apologize for that. But typically at our member briefings, one of the things we like to do is just kind of give you a high level overview on things we're doing. And then if we, leave some time for discussion. And so if there are questions or comments or things that are on your radar that we should know about, this is our chance to do that. And so so you have two options. One, the chat function as part of Microsoft Teams is there. So if you have a question or something there, feel free to ask that. Or also, I've muted, I think, all of you or most of you. If you would prefer to ask a question, feel free. You can unmute yourself and ask that question now as well, too. So anybody have something for the good of the order, a question they'd like to ask? Well, a quiet bunch today. That's quite all right. I'm totally good with that. I know you've got busy days ahead of you. Again, reach out to me anytime at 400-4000. I'll connect you with my team and or me and whoever can help you best here. You can email me at jrea@sbrchamber.com, and we'll get plugged into whatever's going on there. And if there's nothing else, then I think we'll call it a day, and we'll look forward to seeing you next week at some of those events that I mentioned as we were talking. So thank you.